bless this gathering here today. Thank all of you for coming out, for being interested in making Georgetown not just a good place, but a great place. So will you bow your heads with me? Father, we thank you for this wonderful day, for the multiplicity of your grace and of your mercy. Thank you for loving us and having mercy on each of us today. Bless our gathering today. You said if a man will acknowledge you in all of their ways, you shall direct our path. We come acknowledging you today for the future of our city and our county. Lord, we need your direction. Give us a vision where we can move forward and do all the things that you would have us to do. We pray for every family, for every resident in our city and in our county, all of our elected officials, everyone that's here today. Let your richest blessing be upon all of us here this day. Direct us, God, as we listen, as we hear, help us to move forward. We thank you now for you and all you have done. And I pray a blessing on this audience and on our guests today. I wish above all things that you should prosper them, that they should be in health even as their soul prosper. We thank you now in Jesus' matchless name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. I'm Sal Hemingway, County Administrator, and it's great to see such a large crowd here this morning. I think that's a true testament to your concern and your interest level of the future of our community. So thank you so much for being here this morning. I want to thank a few people before we get started, and then we'll move right into this. It's obvious you didn't come to hear me. I will tell you that this effort was the fruit of efforts of a lot of people that, organizations that contributed financially and with other human resources to make this a reality. We are very blessed to have the expertise and knowledge base with these panel members that we have that spent the week with us, and we're all eagerly awaiting to hear what their comments are this morning. I want to expressly thank Geo Sands and the Bunnell Foundation for their support and for their leadership role in this effort. I will also tell you that this has truly been a cooperative effort of the city and county governments. I can't thank the leadership that's been displayed by city council, the mayor, county council, and be taking a proactive approach to addressing an issue here in our community that obviously affects and impacts the future again of Georgetown, the city and county, as well as surrounding areas. It was true a cooperative effort. The county was in charge of facilities, the city was in charge of weather. We thank you, Jack, for that. Two special people that really did the letting work. Team Miller, where's team? T. Miller right here, Brian Tucker. Let's give them a round of applause. And with that, I'm going to hand the mic over to the individual that chaired this effort this week, Alex Rose, standing right here in front. You got a working microphone, Alex? Okay, take it away. Thank you.
Thank you, Sal. Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning,
everybody.
Good morning.
That's Georgetown, I was expecting. This is kind of a cool setting. I've never had people in balconies. I have never. Very, very neat space. So, on behalf of the Urban Land Institute, I want to express our appreciation to the entire Georgetown community for inviting ULI, the panelists, to spend the week with you, this week with you. take a close look at the opportunities and challenges presented by the 150 acres of waterfront property located in and adjacent to the city, and share our findings and recommendations this morning on visioning, land use, and economic development considerations associated with the transition of this property from its historical uses. For nearly 70 years, ULI members have been volunteering their time to come to communities like Georgetown, providing candid and objective and independent advice to help them catalyze and organize their thinking, problem solving, action planning, and execution surrounding land use, various types of land use challenges and opportunities. Before detailing our findings and recommendations, we would like to recognize and thank those responsible for making this assignment possible. We thank you for your leadership, your willingness to come together as Selvidge, to come together for a common goal, your willingness to listen, to roll up your sleeves, and to commit to all the hard work that is before you. The panel, too, would like to express a special recognition to T. Miller and to Brian Tucker. Some of the best briefing materials I have ever seen, some of the most best and deepest organization of the community to help us in our work that I have ever seen. Hats off to you guys. And I've seen a lot of this, so don't say that. But our most important thanks and gratitude goes out to all of you and to the rest of the 800 members of the Georgetown community who took the time to engage with us this week to share your questions, your ideas, your concerns, but most significantly, what the panel detected was your passion about your community and its future. And the reason that's important is that it is that passion and that dedication to your community that is going to enable you to succeed in this endeavor. Of that, we have no doubt. We have a lot to cover this morning, so I won't reintroduce everybody individually. You will be hearing from them shortly. Probably you'll wish you would be hearing from them more shortly and me less. But let me just say that this team comes from across the country and the globe and represents a broad cross-section of the land use profession, all on point to help assess and provide recommendations for the Georgetown community to consider as it moves forward with the work ahead. As a panel, you're also appreciative to our Georgetown base, Washington, D.C. We used to be in Georgetown, the other Georgetown. We are now back in Washington, our staff. I have not seen yet, but so she can raise her hand if she's here, Amy Barrett. Do not see her. But Amy Barrett is the executive director of ULI South Carolina and somebody that each of you need to make sure you know. Like my colleagues here, we have 500 ULI colleagues here in South Carolina. They are here to assist you and support you 24/7, 365 on matters of land use, and I can assure you they will be an invaluable resource, no indistinguishable from the talents and expertise of the panel as you move forward. So let me talk a little bit about process before we dive in here. So this morning's presentation is really a detailed summary of the panel's findings and recommendations. That was our work this week. The report will take about an hour, 15 minutes or so this morning, usually drawn off a little bit longer, so please bear with us. The city and county will have this PowerPoint presentation this afternoon, and the final written report sometime over the next 90 to 120 days. While that final report will reflect in greater detail and with many supporting case studies and explanatory materials to help guide the process from here forward, what you're hearing today is the content of that report, just in significantly reduced fashion. You You may not believe that at the end of this, but trust me. So, a couple of definitions to start. For the panel's purposes this morning, when we refer to the Georgetown communities or the Georgetown, we are referring to the city of Georgetown and all of its various neighborhoods. When the panel distinguishes between the public and the private, public is referring to the city and county of Georgetown and other government agencies and jurisdictions, where private includes not only private property and commercial interests, but also that of institutional, nonprofit, faith, and similar non-government entities. A couple of other definitions you'll hear along the line, but try and be a little bit consistent in how we refer to things. So in May of last year, as you all know much better than we, the city of Georgetown endured the third and perhaps final shutdown of the steel mill, eliminating most of the remaining 226 jobs. Similarly, with the dwindling level of activity and increasing capital requirement to regain and maintain its peak viability, the Port of Georgetown is a mere shell of its previous status as an important source of jobs and economic vitality in the city and county of Georgetown. The Georgetown communities clearly face accelerating economic crisis, jobs loss and degradation, and a deepening social imbalance. At the same time, the Georgetown communities have the rare opportunity for a community to reimagine and revitalize a key and highly visible 150-acre water site. They just don't come around. So that's what brings us to this morning. The very size of the land involved, the complexity of its history, its ownership, its place in the physical and economic landscape of the Georgetown communities, and the physical, economic, and social challenges and opportunities faced by Georgetown dictate the need for a thoughtful, comprehensive, and far-looking vision, process, plan, and resources to overcome those challenges and capture those opportunities. Now, lest you think you are alone, cities far larger and more experienced at tackling these types of sites and circumstances and doing so with far greater resources than the city of Georgetown struggle with these types of tasks, no less. They are not easy. I can tell you from the extensive, late night, passionate, panel discussions and debates this week, you are most certainly looking at a difficult task. This is not easy. So what's the way forward? Because just because it's not easy doesn't mean it's not achievable. Georgetown is a city of incredibly unique and authentic assets, most notably the surrounding natural resources, its industrial history, and its cultural heritage. You know this much better than we, and the panel will highlight many of these assets as it lays out its findings and recommendations this morning. Since the founding of the Republic, one of the inalienable rights and responsibilities reserved to the states and local jurisdictions has been the power to control the use of land within their respective borders. At a very visible level, that power enables a community to determine its physical layout and organization. However, at a much more significant and impactful and lasting level, exercise of that right is one of the most important tools the community holds and can exercise to uniquely mold its assets and establish for itself and for its citizens the community's identity, culture, lifestyle, and most significantly, its pathways to sustainable economic viability and success. This week, the panel has been studying the city of Georgetown with a particular focus placed on the 150 acres of waterfront land, which encompasses the steel mill, the Port of Georgetown, and a number of other publicly and privately owned lands. Those lands are shown outlined on the slide, and throughout this presentation, the panel will generally be referring to all of this as the site. So the site doesn't necessarily mean the steel mill or the port or some of the other properties. It's the site is the correct. The site and how Georgetown exercises its powers of land use control represent the most critical part in determining and shaping Georgetown's identity, culture, and economic viability for the next 50 to 100 years. The public already owns and controls a substantial portion of the site. The panel knows that the steel mill portion of the site is privately owned. The panel believes that there may be pathways to public ownership and control of that portion of the site if that's what the community desires and decides to do. However, and this is a very important however, the vision and the plan and the objectives and the tasks the panel will recommend this morning are not dependent upon actual ownership. The pathways to achievement of these objectives may vary depending on how ownership and control is exercised. But the objectives are not. The objectives is what the community must continue to focus on. Whether by public acquisition and ownership, by exercise of its land use powers, or more likely, some combination of both, the Georgetown community has the responsibility and the power to determine its future through the lens of the site and the community-wide dialogue and decision-making processes in which the community must engage. In starting this long and involved process of shaping its future through land use control, the Georgetown community has asked for, and the panel concurs, that a set of guiding principles, a vision, if you will, is essential. That vision, an expression of what Georgetown wants to be, must be the guidepost that both leads the community engagement and decision-making process that must start today. But the guidepost, at the same time, is the guidepost that the community returns to as it makes future decisions over the next 20 or so years that it is likely to take to fully transform the site. The vision includes, or must include, at least 10 guiding principles. First, the planning and execution for reuse of the site must recognize but not be bound by the historic context of the Georgetown community, which is its heritage, its culture, neighborhoods, natural settings, and community assets. That means that the plan must not only celebrate the richness of the community's past, but must proactively face and resolve the difficulties and challenges of that past, particularly social and economic. The plan must account for and lay the foundation for providing a means to mitigate and erase historic and significant differences within the community in terms of employment, educational opportunities and attainment, conditions of infrastructure and housing. When looking through the lens of the site, the proper vision and consequent plan must look to and address benefit Georgetown holistically. Number two, the site is and must continue to be a catalyst for transformative change. It's an incubator. It is the starting place for the new Georgetown, a new economic, jobs-driven revitalization that does not threaten, but rather enhances the unique post-industrial Georgetown asset base. It is the bridge to creating a community that will retain and attract the community's youth and future generations. It's a bridge metaphorically, it is a bridge physically. This process actually could not begin anywhere else in the city. Third, Georgetown community's control of the site is indispensable. Fourth, the ultimate plan for the site must be simultaneously aspirational and challenging to the status quo. Fifth, the site represents a historic opportunity in terms of community planning in the broadest sense of that term, physically, economically, socially. This is where Georgetown is placing its bet on its future. The plan for the site must facilitate and encourage entrepreneurial risk-taking, which will, in turn, and over time, see more established and diverse jobs and consequent investment in the community. Community and economic growth starts with established assets. You know that you have them in abundance. Craftsmen, established and emerging players in recreation and lifestyle, pioneers in art and culture and food, they all seize on these types of assets and thrive and grow. And this is a story that we see happening that has been repeated and is happening throughout the country and throughout the globe in cities big and small, urban, suburban, and rural. Even the site itself will produce jobs as the vestiges of its industrial past are removed, environmental conditions are addressed, and new uses find homes. Jobs and economic growth does not start with an elusive employer suddenly bringing to the community hundreds of jobs. It's a very organic process. Next, the plan for the site must capture, protect, enhance, and leverage the unique recreational and cultural assets which have always defined the city of Georgetown. Jobs tied to these assets can be immediate. They are a critical economic base upon which to grow and achieve the longer-term diverse economic objectives of the vision. Next, public sector must place the first stake in the ground. Let me repeat that. The public sector must place the first stake in the ground. That is leadership, that is economic, that is financial. That is what is essential for the private sector to undertake the major portion of the invested time and capital needed to effect the transformational change. Any plan for the site, however, must be a responsible use of the public resources, be they land, capital, or otherwise. Ninth, plan for the site must accommodate and facilitate changes created by an expected ripple effect. What does that mean? By executing change on the site, change will be sparked in the surrounding Georgetown neighborhoods and Georgetown's regional assets. Change, the ripple effect, is also multi-directional. Change emanating from the site offers the opportunity to preserve and enhance the pre-existing positive assets of the surrounding area. Historical, physical, and social barriers are lowered, blending into a more holistic Georgetown, while still retaining the distinct characteristics that make each and every block and each and every neighborhood uniquely Georgetown. And finally, the plan for the site is recognized that the site is not homogeneous, and that lack of homogeneity, combined with its pivotal location and size, represents one of its greatest opportunities. Ownership and control is varied, the timing availability of portions of land are varied, it can be broken up into many different pieces, each exerting its own impact on economic growth, but most importantly, tied together by a common vision. Time frame for all of this starts today, but it's likely to extend over 20 or more years until you get full realization of your plan and your vision. So, now you get to hear somebody other than my wonderful voice. The panel's detailed findings and recommendations are divided this morning into three parts. An assessment of the current and projected market forces that impact the development and use of the site. A recommended planning framework and the development that framework would be expected to yield, all in response to the combined force of Georgetown's land use, control, and market conditions as they evolve. Not to control the market conditions. And finally, a recommended action plan for achievement of Georgetown's objectives. So let me turn the podium and mic over to Jeff Koski, Kathleen Rose, and Juanita Hardy to share the panel's assessment of the current and projected market opportunities.
As part of our report, we've prepared a summary of economic and real estate market conditions. We've pulled out some of the pertinent pieces of data to set the context and to make the case for redevelopment that we'll show you today. But what we've included today is really just the tip of the iceberg of the data to help understand the situation. The briefing book that the sponsor prepared, along with the city's comprehensive plan, which is currently being updated, provides a vast treasure trove of data for reference and a deeper dive into the supply and demand data. So we're just kind of giving you a glimpse into the amount of data that we've looked at. The local market area currently lacks adequate demand drivers to accommodate redevelopment of the entire site in the short term. However, the site size and location on the waterfront, adjacent to the historic downtown, provide a longer-term opportunity for mixed-use, water-oriented development. The city of Georgetown, whose economy over the past two centuries has largely been tied to the economic activities at this site, has not garnered its fair share of population growth as compared to Georgetown County overall, as compared to its regional coastal counterparts, nor compared to the state of South Carolina. As seen on this slide, while the state and your peers have seen growth over the past 5 years, the city has seen population decline, according to the U.S. Census. Further, the city of Georgetown finds itself in a dire predicament with low household incomes and poverty. The origins of this predicament can be directly attributed to the area's early economic dependence on a plantation economy that was completely reliant on human bondage. Although the slave economy built Georgetown into the largest rice exporting port in the world by the antebellum period, it created a permanent underclass that has persisted into the current era. Slavery, followed by Jim Crow segregation, and other variables have severely limited the black community's economic mobility. To wit, the city of Georgetown, whose population is 58% black, has a median income at 67% below South Carolina overall. As you can see on this slide, the lagging median income of the city of Georgetown. Further, the population can be characterized as older and aging. Although the area serves as a retiree destination, which can be a positive in economic development terms, the pace of aging due to stagnant population growth is a threat, and the economic well-being of the city is in danger. Both Horry and Charleston counties attract large number of retirees and younger professional households, creating a well-rounded economic opportunities and bright futures. The redevelopment of this site must serve as a catalyst to reestablish multi-generational opportunities in the city of Georgetown. The implications of stagnant growth, low incomes, and an aging population in the city of Georgetown pose substantial challenges for a market-driven solution at the site. But all is not lost. The public sector will need to intervene early on and to provide incentives and insurances of long-term participation to provide redevelopment and economic development momentum. Further, local educational and nonprofit institutions will likely need to play a role in the realization of the development vision that we will present to you today. And this could come either as partners or as end users on the site. With its size and location, the potential exists to generate demand on the site as the vision is implemented, creating synergies among the various land uses and to provide support for successful redevelopment. Thus, the future opportunities for the site lie in a mix of uses that allow economic functions appropriate for the 21st century, including business enterprises, institutional, educational, and other functions, as well as tourist draws. The future vision for the site will attract both local users and consumers, as well as destination-oriented tourists and businesses seeking unique, authentic waterfront experiences. This combination of target markets that is outlined here can be characterized using the local vocabulary, from here and come here. By providing a location for from here institutions to grow and to thrive, the site can allow the city of Georgetown to project a reputation for stability and, importantly, forward-looking growth. In addition, the site provides an opportunity to attract come-here enterprises and consumers. The vision for redevelopment on the site can help recast Georgetown as a location for new businesses and residents seeking quality of life and quality location. This plan, if executed properly, can provide elements that attract young professionals and the creative class. The creative class is a term used for those who earn a living through imaginative and creative activities and often seek authentic locations that offer high-quality experiences. These locations throughout the nation are typically in walkable, mixed-use historic downtowns. Our vision for the site that you'll see soon can attract the creative class. Over 1 million people live within 90 minutes of downtown Georgetown by car. This market audience spends $14 billion annually on retail goods. The key is to tap into that $14 billion economy. Moreover, the state of South Carolina is the ninth fastest growing state in the nation. Thus, the larger market area and spending capacity is poised to grow. A successful redevelopment of the site hinges upon the fact that new uses will capture new dollars into the local economy, significantly growing the current limited real estate demand. And with that, Kathleen will dig in a little deeper.
Good morning, everyone. As Jeff said, this paints a little bit of a stark picture of current reality. However, in order to create and drive demand and growth in the community and real estate demand for the site, that begins with jobs, and we heard that throughout the week. But jobs begin with an underpinning foundation of education, because there's a direct correlation between education, job growth, and income. So it has been said that if you give a man a fish, you feed him for a day. But if you teach a man to fish, you feed him for a lifetime. And so, the correlation between educational attainment, employment or unemployment, and income are all well documented. Economic mobility and the ability to be economically self-sufficient is intrinsically tied to education and opportunity. There is much discussion nationally and, as Jeff mentioned, around the creative class and the economic impacts of business and activity, regardless of educational attainment, whether high school graduate, technical or trade school, or four-year bachelor degree or higher. And as you can see from the chart, it's important to move the needle in terms of economic mobility particularly for our young African-American community. And in the region, the bachelor's degrees are higher, as 17% of the city of Georgetown enjoys a bachelor degree or higher, and in the county, it's 24%. The working population by educational attainment improves, provides insight into the skills of the labor force. And the education and intellectual capital is important not only to attract companies to the region, but for housing, employment, and entrepreneurship as well. In Georgetown, the influx of retirees and second home buyers provides a resource for intellectual capital, as such residents can provide mentoring, advisory services, and other contributions to the local business environment, particularly with startups and small business. Thus, education remains a critical factor in the new economy. Educational assets are valuable partners, and there's many of them, and they include public and private K-12 schools, postgraduate education, including the O.R.A. Georgetown Technical College, Carolina Coastal University, as well as the College of Charleston, University of South Carolina, and Clemson University, all who have research and programs in the area. So it's really important to get all these educational institutions together to begin the conversation about improving education, job training, and opportunity for the local community. And that's so that they can create their own jobs. It's called economic gardening, grow from within and create organic growth from the residents within the community to attract also folks from outside the community. The definitions of economic development and its success vary greatly, and it requires a sustained, concerted actions of policymakers and communities to promote a standard of living and economic health of an area. Economic development and its success depends on multiple areas of development, including human capital, critical infrastructure, regional competitiveness, education, and public health and safety. Economic development is a policy intervention with endeavors to aim with the aims of economic and social well-being of all its people. The primary focus of such efforts is really through four primary areas. So when you talk to most economic developers, they're focused on four things: attraction of new large employers. And that's usually seen with the large single-purpose operations and large sites for industrial or office uses that you see throughout the county. And there's over 1,000 acres available in the region for that specific purpose. And that's not what we're suggesting here. Second is business retention and expansion. And that is to encourage small business that already exists here and is growing, and some small seed companies that are already in the shadows, if you will, doing great things in Georgetown, to help them grow and nurture and develop and continue to be successful here, and giving them the tools to do that. The third and most important is small business and entrepreneurship. And that's a difficult task, because many people have different ideas of what small business and entrepreneurship is. From Main Street to the rural areas, entrepreneurship can be anything from tech companies to food purveyors to a number of variety of things that can help nurture and grow small business. And lastly, tourism, bringing visitors and revenue into the local economy. And that includes, when we say tourism, we think of attractions and t-shirt shops and the beach, but that can also mean things like recreational sports of boating, fishing, hunting, and other water sports, eco and cultural tourism, architectural tourism, many different options that you have here from the rich palette of assets that you have. And so when we look at these sectors, we really begin to try to understand what drives the local economy. And what's interesting is, even though we know that the largest employers are those in the healthcare professions, with the hospital, the education, with the schools, as well as the international paper plant, the reality is that the folks that actually live here work in primarily three sectors. And that includes accommodations and food services, retail trade, and of course, manufacturing. Of these two, the first two are considered local or service employment, from which folks in the local community have to travel outside for employment. And that totals 35% of the total economy. However, what's really interesting to know, and what we find, is that with economic base, which are basically the leading sectors that drive the economy, so the sectors that really create the money flow within and around the community, are in a different arena. And so location quotients really are the underlying theme that jobs drive demand for real estate, and those jobs that are already the sectors that are creating opportunity in the area create a multiplier effect, thus improving population and growth and revenue within the area benefiting from the job growth. And corresponding job growth or decline in jobs, population and income correspond to real estate. There really are two types of jobs: those jobs that export their good or service outside of the market, and jobs that create opportunity within the local market. And the ones that export their good or service have the greatest impact and thus are compared to the national average. Anything over 1.0 is a substantial contributor to driving that community greater than the national average. So what you'll see up here are the primary sectors, including arts, entertainment, and recreation. And so the existing economic base, as well as the demographic and economic influences to Georgetown, set the stage to strengthen and expand existing sectors and also diversify the economy to create jobs and economic health. Workforce labor and occupational skills are important in this transition. The most direct path would include leveraging existing skills, for example, machinists, electricians, and craftsmen, who can translate those skills into new or different industries. This includes specific strategies to grow companies and provide catalysts for small business and entrepreneurship based on two themes, innovation and arts and culture. And first, I'm going to talk about innovation. Innovation includes new technologies and diversification, new applications, and new industry sectors. This includes healthcare, agriculture, aquaculture, marine biology, ecology, energy, and other emerging sectors that would focus on the land and the sea. To best prepare students for the new economy, and must include math, science, technology, engineering, and math, or STEM. Initiatives in this area are already underway in the region at the K-12 level, and this can be further developed with apprenticeship and internship programs with undergraduate and graduate programs currently being offered by the college and universities in the region, including what's the research going on in Habitat Barony and the Coastal Carolinas Center for Marine and Wetland Studies at the Harbor Walk. The resulting activities fuel such commercial uses as research centers, classrooms, incubators, co-working spaces, live workspaces, and related housing, retail, and entertainment options to support them. To give you some ideas and visions of some relevant projects, we included a few here. Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute in Massachusetts, the Mystic Seaport in Connecticut, and last but not least, the Pike Place Public Market in Seattle, which is created to connect the city's citizens and farmers. It's a market and a beloved landmark that encompasses the historic district overlooking the bay. The market remains a bustling center of farm-fresh, locally sourced, and artisanal specialty foods. It's a place where you can meet the producer, the farmers, the butchers, the fishmongers, cheesemongers, bakers, winemakers, and purveyors who bring their bounty to your table. The market includes one of the largest craft markets for locally handmade goods. So with 225 small independent businesses and a diverse array of restaurants, this might provide a small model of what could be in Georgetown.
Thank you, Kathleen, and good morning, everyone. So I'm going to talk about art as an economic driver, but before I jump into that, I just want to say a few words about STEAM. My colleague, Kathleen, talked about STEM, and STEAM puts arts into the equation. If we're going to realize innovation, the way we realize innovation is by developing critical thinking skills, and arts have proven to do that. So when we think about a curriculum, we want to think about including classes that speak to the creative skills. Things like graphic art design, advertising, music, production. All of these things are helpful. And whether you're looking at a technical field or otherwise, arts education is an important component of that. Now, I'd like to, at this point, jump into a discussion about art as an economic driver. It represents $135 billion of economic benefit. And it creates, and this is nationally, over 4 million jobs. Now, let's bring that down to home to Georgetown. You heard Kathleen talk about the economic base, and art on that chart represented the number one, the top contributor to the economic base here in the county of Georgetown. Now compare that number to Horry's performance and Charlestown County's performance, and what you see is Georgetown exceeds Horry, and it contributes, its contribution to the economic base is three times that of Charlestown. So art and culture as an economic base and its contribution to Georgetown is quite significant. You have some jewels in this town. You have some jewels in the county, and especially in this town. You don't have to go far to see it. You can just walk along Front Street, which I had the pleasure of doing earlier this week. Just within a few blocks, there are a number of cultural assets there. There is the Kaminsky House, the Stuart Parker House, there is the Maritime Museum, there is the Rice Museum. And that is, along there, you have galleries, you have restaurants, you have wonderful retail shops. A lot concentrated right in that small area. And anyone that happens into that area, deliberately or by accident, generally stays, at least for the day, often overnight, and they are spending money. They're spending a lot of money that's contributing to your economic base. You have, and I know you know this, but you have some fabulous assets that need to be leveraged, promoted, expanded, and you have the ability to do that. We've talked about this a long time frame leading up to realizing your vision for the site, but there are a lot of things that can be done in the short term. The chart that you see here shows that Georgetown ranks eighth among its economic contribution to tourism, and that's a total of $313 million. This is in 2014. So one way you can leverage those assets is, and think about growth, is through creative placemaking. What do I mean by that? So this is a definition for creative placemaking. I am not going to go into these details. You can read it. But there are two things that I like to say about it. Number one, creative placemaking has to do not just with changing the physical character of a space or place, but also the social character. And it is the combination of those two things that become, that drive that economic engine I'm talking about. When you can change the physical and also the social and attract energy and people to that space and get the community involved in that space, that translates into dollars and economic benefit for Georgetown. Now, I'm going to give three examples to amplify this point. The first one is called the Hall. It's a temporary art use in a community in San Francisco. It could be a community anywhere in the country, but it happens to be planted in San Francisco. A community that has a number of social challenges. A building that sat blighted for 7 years was purchased by two developers. And as the developers are seeking entitlements, which is going to take some time, they've had this property for a couple of years, they decided to activate that space. And they decided to do it in a way that got the community engaged. They solicited six food truck drivers, food truck owners, to put stalls in the space. So there's, you know, like a food court type environment with a bar. And so they're learning their trade as restaurant owners, future restaurant owners, and building a clientele. In addition to that, in terms of engaging the community, they have offered the space as free space to any nonprofit in the community. So far, they serve about 4,000 meals a week, the food truck owners. They have had over 90 free events there. They've donated $35,000 to local nonprofits. They hold a monthly breakfast. They've done 11 so far. And they address youth homelessness through a job fair that they had for the youth. So you can just get a sense of what I'm talking about from the images that we see there. That has gotten the community engaged, and it has transformed that community. This project, by the way, is a finalist in the ULI Global Excellence Award. Now let's look at the community revitalization project in Macon, Georgia. This is Mill Hill. The image you see there is an auditorium in Mill Hill. It just got a new roof, okay? Mill Hill, many of you have been there, you know it. It's the birthplace of Macon, Georgia. It used to be a village for working people and families at a local textile mill that is now lighted, over 46% lighted. The vision that the community has for Mill Hill is that it will become a gateway that connects the community to nearby tourist assets and attract visitors to the space. Again, anytime you hear attracting visitors, think of dollar signs, right? Vacant mill houses will be transformed into affordable artist livable space. And the Mill Hill Auditorium will become a community arts center. In that arts center will be a culinary arts school. Why? They did an asset inventory and found that most of the people in that community like to cook. So they're doing culinary arts. They're going to build on the assets in that community. And the vision that they have is that Mill Hill will be an affordable place for the residents that live there and will attract a lot of new energy to the area as well. My own project I want to talk about is Bethlehem Steel. This was a former steel site, Bethlehem Steel Company, that closed its doors in, let me say, 1999, after over 100 years of operation. The steel steps, the image you see there, is an exciting place. If you ever get a chance to visit there, I encourage you to do so. It has been transformed into an art and cultural canvas. It features preserved glass furnaces and other historic buildings on the site. An elevated walkway allowing you to look close up right down into the furnaces. A visitor exhibit center in one of the historic buildings. There are parks and outdoor plazas where you can sit and eat. There's an outdoor performing arts pavilion, so in the summer, imagine thousands of people on the pavilion. And there are other buildings there as well. It is an iconic structure, and it's quite amazing to approach it during day or at night if you have the opportunity to see it in other places. This site produced the steel for the Chrysler Building and the Golden Gate Bridge, so you can imagine how large. The preservation, sorry, I'm having trouble with that word, of the steel stacks was an important decision for the citizens of Bethlehem, right? And so now they stand with honor and with pride looking at this site, but seeing it transformed into something quite wonderful and quite meaningful for its community. This was a massive project, and it took many years, over 20 years, to pull off. And the transformation of Georgetown and the site will also take time. But there are many things that you can do right now. Let me just talk briefly about what those are. Three ideas. One is you can think about a rebranding of Georgetown. I talked to folks that walked along that the street that said that they happened there, and once they found it, they wanted to stay. So be proud, tout your stuff, get the word out that you got a lot of jewels right here. You know that, I know. Because you know that most, that your tourists spend more than twice, almost three times, what tourists spend in Horry County and in Charleston. So you have a quality visitor that comes here and spends money. Rebrand. Second thing, think about creative place-making initiatives that you can do right now. I gave you some ideas. Some of them are long-term. They don't have to be. They can be short-term things. Get together, brainstorm on what things you can do now to activate spaces, to solve community problems, and do it through art and cultural assets. The third thing, simple idea. Put an outpost, your visitor center, on Fraser Street, or on 17, Route 17. So that when people approach, they don't just by accident go in. Many of them are coming here to live with it, but those that are, you know, have them be interested and bring them into the space. It may be a long time to implement the vision for the site, but you can begin to have an impact now. Thank you for your time. And now I would like to turn it over to John to discuss the development framework for the site.
Thank you, Juanita. This has been really interesting, not I'm sure only for the audience, but for myself as well. I'm just learning and watching this in a whole different light this morning, somehow. We're here to talk about something you might be very interested at this point, which is the actual development vision for the site. And to talk about that with me are my colleagues. Let me introduce my colleagues. Ross Tilden is a transportation expert. Ken Kay is a land planning and development expert. I'm a development and investment expert. And together we've assisted our colleagues on the panel to put together the details for the site vision that we all arrived at by consensus. Speaking of my day job, I couldn't help but notice, I've got here on the podium something called back home a translation device, because someone will just carry this and plug it into their ear and they don't understand English or Polish or very much a crossroads culture. They can get assistance in understanding what the speaker is saying. But here, I hope we're all speaking the same language. I think that's something I think we should start from, establishing a common language. With that, let me just get into some of the details that refer to some of the elements, but again, some of the physical aspects of this that my colleagues have mentioned. So we're faced at the beginning with two primary challenges. One is obviously a physical character, and that is replacing what has been a dominant feature in the Georgetown landscape for many, many years. And the second has got really a social dimension, and that is really creating a catalyst for the community to grow and develop going forward. So that's the background of all of this thing. And as Alex has mentioned, and my colleagues have mentioned, this site has many owners. That adds an additional immediate layer of complexity, although it didn't affect our blue sky thinking. That does add an element which you've got to be aware of. This will take time. This is not a single owner site. People have to talk to each other and negotiate that vision going forward. So that, be prepared, this will take an additional amount of time. Now the site, just a few characteristics which is going to give background to discussion, obviously dominates the waterfront. And it abuts Front Street, and at some part of the site really constitutes an extension of Front Street, which is a very important part of what I think can be phase one of this development, which we call Georgetown Commons, a place where literally the two communities, all parts of the city come together. My colleague Ken is going to supply some more detail about that in a minute, but I think this is where the project could actually have its beginnings. It also runs parallel, as Juanita has mentioned, to Fraser Street and to a community called the West End District. And this is absolutely critical physically and symbolically to what we're thinking about doing with the site.
And this is the area that I'm referring to, where the corner of the site constitutes perhaps phase one of the project, what we're calling Georgetown Commons. Now, another important feature, we mentioned Fraser Street and US 17. This is something that visitors coming to town see immediately, and it's something where we can affect an immediate improvement visually, but also symbolically in the community. By improving both sides of the street, you're going to send a new signal to people coming into the site, coming into the project, this is a new Georgetown. So this is an obvious and actually fairly straightforward way to make an immediate change in Georgetown. Now, stepping back, what do we want the site to be, considering all that background? Should it be an industrial site? Should it be a commercial site? Should it be a residential site? Should it be all of the above? Should it have recreational opportunities? And what should be accomplished by the new site functions? Well, these answers are going to be, or the answers to these questions lie in an analysis of not only the physical characteristics of the site, but also the market aspects, which my colleagues just before me talked about. So what we know about the site, let's answer the first question, and take the first dimension, which is kind of the industrial question, which is hanging out there. The site has obviously got a legacy as a location for heavy industry, but that industry has relied upon the port activity. What we know is that the port needs to be dredged. It's going to take a lot of money to dredge it, and the feasibility studies to justify the expenditure don't seem to think that that's a good expenditure of money. So I think we can, at the very beginning at least, our feeling was, cross out that industrial use. Let's move on to think about what other future uses of the site might be. In addition, we spent a good amount of time talking to members of the community. We directly interviewed over 100 people on a single day, and we sent surveys to additional members of the community. In total, contacted over 800 members of the Georgetown community. What you're telling us is that we've got to improve the overall impression of Georgetown. This site is going to help do that, hopefully. And I've mentioned Fraser Street. I've mentioned Georgetown Commons at the intersection of 17 and Front Street. It's got to provide opportunities to access the waterfront, to activate the waterfront, to bring it back into the everyday life of the community. It's got to provide high-quality green space so you can get out and relax once in a while and enjoy that waterfront, filled with public art. It's got to provide access physically and views to that waterfront, even if you're not there every day, using those spaces. And most importantly, it's got to provide opportunities for establishing high-value job-creating activities, which are going to come from the following sectors, I think. Commercial, technical, artistic, Juanita has talked about what an impact that can have on the community. An educational sector, which is going to provide the base for future, even future and greater growth. And of course, natural beauty abounds around, so recreational sector is also going to be a very important component of future job growth. And I think it's important just to remind you what we based our recommendations on in this quick and intense week. We visited the site, we've taken city tours, we reviewed extensive information which has been provided to us by the folks in the city and the county. We have mentioned the interviews that we've conducted, the surveys that we've received, and our review of the market data. All of this has been put into a big blender this week and has resulted in the vision we're going to talk about. And I think it's important to remind ourselves at this point that this is not a design blueprint we're about to show you, but it's a vision and a strategy. So it's not something you can take out and apply for a building permit tomorrow. It requires much more extensive thought and discussion amongst your members of the community to arrive at a final blueprint.
And again, the time element is important. We think that this is probably a 20-year, more or less, project. Although some parts of the project, as I've alluded to with Georgetown Commons, can probably start a lot sooner. Ken's going to refer to the phasing after talking about those individual project components. So again, with that background, I'd like to introduce Ross. Ross is a transport expert in his everyday job, and he's going to be talking about one very critical framework underneath all of this, and it's access and circulation to the site. Ken Kay is going to talk about the development zones and the actual functions within those zones, and then the possible phasing. So with that, Ross.
Thank you, John. Good morning, everyone. So the development framework, how do we help deliver the vision that's been articulated? The plan the panel recommends reflects the vision for a place that facilitates incubation, education, entrepreneurship, and recreation. It enables public access, commercial and non-commercial activities appealing to all people, both citizens and visitors. The framework plan begins with defining access and circulation, where people, cars, bikes go. It's important to open up the site with a comprehensive network of street connections, view corridors, pedestrian linkages connecting the water to the neighborhoods, to downtown. Now, these elements include on-site elements and off-site parts of circulation. On the site, the framework provides for creating public rights of way. And again, those public rights of way link the neighborhoods to the new uses on the site and to the water. It also extends Georgetown's existing block pattern, the same blocks that define virtually all portions of the town. To the extent possible, we want to extend that across the site. That establishes a development pattern consistent with other portions of the community, with York history and urban fabric. Now, this approach creates multiple ownership opportunities, literally block by block, or even within portions of blocks. And it results in new development that complements the neighborhoods and historic character you already have. Furthermore, by extending those blocks, that helps define, which is defined by those public rights of way, you automatically create views to the harbor. Now, off the site, it's important to tame South Fraser Street, otherwise known as US Highway 17, so that, as John mentioned, it becomes a welcoming entry with a new look and feel, as a gateway corridor and as a better place to walk, safer place to walk. It currently poses a barrier due to its width, traffic volume, number of trucks, and traffic speed, and not to mention noise. Now, there are opportunities to create a street more compatible with the adjacent neighborhood, the West End, and with future mixed-use development on the site. Ways to do that would include landscaping the street to create a sense of arrival. You come off the bridge, you realize you're in Georgetown. And landscaping, along with site development, can help create attractive views out to the water and over to downtown. Signalizing key intersections would help regulate traffic and create safe places to cross the street. Reducing the speed limit from 35 miles an hour to 30 can make a tremendous difference in making the street more walkable, and it improves pedestrian safety. It greatly reduces the risk of a fatality should a collision occur when it occurs at slower speeds. There are opportunities to shorten pedestrian crossings, again making it a more appealing place to across the street. And it's important in thinking about the land uses to create a what we call a double-loaded street, to have small-scale mixed uses on both sides of the street. That makes it more attractive, slows traffic, and the small-scale uses lend themselves to locally generated businesses, not just commercial drive-through franchises. And it may be worth investigating an alternate Route 17 to carry truck traffic and to take a portion of fleet traffic that simply isn't going to stop off of South Fraser Street, so that street really serves the neighborhood. And then another important off-site improvement that extends from the site out is to convert the rail line to a multi-use path for walking and cycling. This can provide really convenient access for many residents to the site, to the water, and into downtown. We know that some have advocated for retaining rail rights of way for future potential passenger use. We think this particular spur would better serve the community as a multi-use path. So that circulation framework helps establish the scale at which development will occur. And to tell more about the development, the uses of the land that could occur there, Ken will walk you through the various illustrations we have.
Got a swap. Hello, everybody. Good morning. There's a lot of information. We all worked very hard to do this, and pleased to be here this morning. I wanted to stand here because I would like to point to the drawing that we have up here. If we can turn on the next one, which would be great. Oh, I have it again. There we go. Okay, here we go. Now, I'm going to present this development framework plan today, which is really represents a grand vision of the build-out of the project that intentionally creates a framework that is flexible, but over time shouldn't break. And it is one that incorporates circulation, open space, and intent to create places that are identifiable and places that you can build in and around. And it's going to build mostly on the strength of your community. You have a terrific place here, and I can tell you I've enjoyed my few moments in the sun. Spent a lot of time in conference rooms, and we've had a chance to walk, the site, and really get a feeling of this place. So the way that you create places with the situation that we're in is you build on the strengths of your community, which means you have a strong history, you're a very walkable, friendly town. This happens to be an industrial site that's employed people, which has had its day maybe. And now there's this, I think, a golden opportunity, as the others have said, to really take the walls down. Open it up. South Fraser Street really should be a grand boulevard that people go through and you see the water. The West End should connect physically to the water. The downtown boardwalk should be expanded and connected by the water. Everything here is about your working waterfront and how to create that over time, incrementally, not all at once. It's going to take many years. And strong leadership to accomplish this goal. We're giving you the first baby step in a process that's going to take a while. So most of you don't work with plans every day like we do, so I want to just explain what's on the wall. This is called a plan view. It's like if you're in an airplane, you're looking straight down, and we do that because we need to measure things so we can make sure that we're doing things in some coordinated way. So this is our site. Let's see, is this working? Is that, Oh yeah, there it is. Okay, sorry. So here's the complete site, which is here, 150 acres. It goes all the way around here, and it kind of stops right there. And it's on, this is Front Street, and that's South Fraser. And we're calling it South Fraser and not Highway 17, because we would like Highway 17 to the intent of going very fast and getting someplace to kind of slow down here at this gateway as you come in, and also provides a gateway here as you come in this way. So this street should be really reduced in scale, but also should be friendly. And once the wall comes down in the mill, and I don't know how much, maybe it's partial or it's whole, or but part of it should open up so you can see the water. Because that's what's going to attract people. That little flicker of water will get people to drive down Front Street, park, walk around, figure out what to do during the day. And the more you expand your amenities, like we talked about before, the more people will come and the longer they'll stay. The longer they'll stay, the more they eat, the more they'll drink, and the more fun that they will have while they're here. And it's going to be very important to do that. So we have created, you can see there's an outline, we have to create a there. So what is that there? That's the question. What can we do? And our panel has really said we need to start in an area and we need to work on a couple areas to really make this happen. And we've shown some diagrams, but in these diagrams really have to be tested, they have to be built on. So this shows basically a phase that we call the Georgetown Commons, and that circle right there really is going to be your, in New England they would say, and down here that would be your town square. And so it's an opportunity to take the boardwalk up from this point and extend it up as far as this area right here, where there's kind of a large concrete deck that's there right now that we think would be a nice thing to preserve and to actually use as kind of a mooring for the shrimp boats and make it kind of an industrial looking, but historic kind of community like some of the slides have shown. And so we're thinking that the corners, which I'm going to talk about in a little bit more detail, would have some civic uses in this area and a hotel. And then all along Fraser Street would be mixed use development, which would be here, meaning that with all of these the grid lines that come in, there'll be an opportunity to do shops facing out, and they'll do, people will be able to cross the street. And then when we get into this area down here, where we're looking at building a university village with the research. This is something Kathleen talked about, which is very exciting, with some residential. And so the boardwalk will extend all the way over to the port, where the port building is right now. And it's an opportunity for a small waterfront park at the end. That would be kind of at the end of the process, because we're thinking of starting the process and building from your existing community. That's how it's going to work. And so anyway, the if we could go to the next slide, I get control of it, so I can go. So to the people in the audience, can you see that? I mean, if you feel like you can understand that map. I don't have much time, and I think we're a little bit behind, so I'm rushing through it in a way. So let me go. Next one. There we go. Here's some examples of places that have been very successful in terms of transforming a site like this. It's hard to imagine that you go out there, and then what would you do? So the top picture shows an actual example of a sawmill up in Bend, Oregon, and that was 25 years ago. And I've been actually working on this project, and we've finished it, and it's been a sort of a grand finalist award. But I've been through this process and this project, and so have people on our staff. So there is hope, and there's a vision, but it's going to take a while. This shows using some of the historic buildings. This shows the interior of it. This is the Gasworks project in Seattle, which is very, very popular. And it does have some remnants of what the mill was prior to that, so it has a historic reference to it. And then this is also the old mill district. And it shows that some of the pieces and parts that are on the site right now are really part of the history. It touches on the history. And also the art part of this is very important. Now let me go quickly. So these are maps again. So you're looking down flat. And the big map you saw is the one below, and that big orange arrow points to a blow up of the area on top, which shows Fraser and also shows Front Street. It shows the circle is a green space. And then we're showing kind of a new city hall, a public library, a farmer's market, and a hotel in that area. So that area would be, and one of the benefits of building on that corner is that right now, when you come into town, it takes you a while to get to Front Street, to like when, where something's happening. So we're gonna bring Front Street and activity right into the street. So it's gonna really help to signal without putting a sign with an arrow saying, go down this way. You're gonna wanna see, wanna go down there. So we'll see next. And then we're moving over to the university area, which is on the other side of the site. You can see the area that's there. It's a fairly large area and conducive to having a lot of mixed uses within that site. And so we're thinking of universities, research, some multifamily housing. We heard a lot about bringing the kids home. This might be a place where we can do more intense housing that the kids could live in or seniors could live in and people who do the research. We're thinking that's a possibility. And next. And then I'm going to say Fraser Street, South Fraser Street again, is super important because that's the hard edge, that's the wall. And that's the one that if you break down that barrier, you're allowing the people from the community to, it's transparent. It's not just views, it's kind of walkable and to kind of go through it. So I'm going to not talk anymore. I have all these notes and everything, but I feel like it's hopefully I convey the power of what this diagram can do in the hands of the people when we walk out of here. I mean, there's a lot to the framework, and there's a lot more to say. So I would like to thank you all very much, and I really appreciate being here. Thank you. Introduce Don Edward Sardi.
Okay, thank you all. My colleagues and I are going to talk about strategies and tasks for implementation. Thus far, you've heard about the market and economic component of our presentation. You've heard about the land use. Now we want to talk about what it will actually take in terms of organizing yourselves to get from here to there. Georgetown is at a crossroads. Your present development status results from a logic that has been in place since the city's founding. You can continue to employ that logic to direct the city's evolution, or you can use the ArcelorMittal site to launch a new logic. The panel believes that it's the new logic that will offer you the opportunities by which Georgetown can incubate a new 21st century city in a 21st century South Carolina. First, we want to talk about using the fact that the condition of the steel mill is a mystery to most people who live in Georgetown. It's likely that the condition of the entire waterfront that we've been speaking about is also a mystery. So in order to develop a shared vision, build intellectual capital, and engage diverse stakeholders throughout your city and county, we recommend developing a program accessible to all, and it should be developed to inform, educate, and communicate with all of your residents about planning and revitalization, using the steel mill site, the waterfront, as well as the entire city and county of Georgetown as context. Such a program should incorporate site tours, classrooms taught by local government and non-governmental staff. The program should be practical, literacy level appropriate, culturally competent, and packaged for subsequent self-study. It should provide the opportunity for diverse views and interpretations of history, and it should invite discussion and promote deliberation. It should be a design process, and it should be aimed at moving participants from being a mere audience to vision-driven, non-partisan constituency for progress. Georgetown's collective vision, which you've heard us speak to many times, should shape your goals and priorities for the development not only of the steel mill site, but your entire waterfront. Your shared vision should drive planning and implementation efforts, informed by guiding principles like those we stated earlier. Your vision should describe goals and aspirations to keep Georgetown focused as you move forward and begin to think about all the options you have. Your vision, however, should not be fixed. It should be flexible so as to accommodate changes in local priorities that will occur over time, as well as incorporate impacts from regional and national trends. What is most important is that your vision be collective, informed, and comprehensive. Prioritizing will also be essential, and it involves identifying whatever it is that your entire community believes are important outcomes. The panel repeatedly heard, for example, about the community's desire for waterfront access at the steel mill site, removing barriers to water views that the steel mill currently creates, the importance of Georgetown's waterfront, and the need for green space more evenly distributed throughout the city. The vision should also incorporate other elements that need to be resolved alongside larger community-wide priorities. Examples of these are the need for a new library and a new city hall. In order to capitalize on the opportunity presented by the steel mill site, its contiguous parcels and the entire waterfront, relevant city, county, and state agencies should establish a standalone agency charged with planning and developing the entire waterfront. Besides recruiting professional staff with experience in revitalization and development, a multi-stakeholder steering group should be convened that is comprised of committed representatives of diverse interests at every level of governmental, sectoral, geographic, and issue interests. Working groups or task forces should be launched to help create a broad base for participation and engagement, as well as to increase intellectual capital throughout the city and county. Participants in these working groups should serve for specified terms, and service criteria should be defined so as to recruit the most committed and consistent participation by your citizens and stakeholders. On the area of decision making, we think waterfront revitalization in Georgetown should reflect data-driven and consensus-based decision-making. To that end, we recommend you identify impartial process design, facilitation, documentation, and evaluation, and have these be prominent features of the waterfront agency's external relations. And now I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Tony.
Thanks, Tom. So I'm going to be talking about phase two, planning for development. And the panel, uses the term phase two to refer to that portion of the development process during which the planning tools and community leadership and capacity are developed in the pre-development phases and that are applied to move the project forward. And moving the project forward, you're going to be doing battle, and you're going to be doing battle together, not with each other. And that's very important. So I'm going to go up and use a quote of Dwight D. Eisenhower, which was a great general, president, and can-do guy. And he said, "In planning for battle, I have always found that plans are useless, but that planning is indispensable." And so this is about the indispensable. Site development begins with planning and a plan that's driven by the community's vision. The planning term is followed by who controls the site. ArcelorMittal's 62-acre mill property is the largest piece in this equation, and how that site is controlled is going to significantly impact our planning, environmental assessment, and remediation that is going to go ahead. You know, as needed, as noted in the panel's remarks, the public through the Port Authority already owns and controls a substantial portion of the site, and the panel knows that the steel mill portion of the site is privately owned and has recently been listed for sale, as evidenced by the banner hanging out as of a couple of days ago. The panel has stated unequivocally that it is essential that Georgetown community decide and control the future of the site. Those portions that are currently in public lands and those that are currently in private hands. Whether that control means ownership, regulation, administration, partnering, or exercise of land use regulatory authority is less important than an agreed upon vision of the plan on the site, and that public control is part of the action for the execution. So, about achieving site control. Based on this research this week, and along with the experience of similarly situated communities elsewhere, the panel believes that there may be a number of pathways to public ownership and or control of the public or private portions of the site, if that is what the community desires and decides to go to. And if it decides to, it has to do so resolutely. That must be reflected by the Georgetown community's plan for the site, and as noted, the city's inherent responsibility and authority to control land uses within its borders, subject of course to constitutional constraints, as noted by Alex. It's not only a given, but certainly exercisable within that vision. Planning an action plan framework, recommended by the panel. As noted throughout, the realization and execution of the vision of the plan is a very long-term and dynamic exercise. Dynamic, you have to roll with the punches. That provides both the public and private stakeholders, as well as the Georgetown community, sufficient time to discuss or formally control animal ownership opportunities and alternatives. While it is clear that the Georgetown community lacks sufficient financial resources for an outright acquisition of the public and private portions of the site, those are not the only alternatives that are available. Alternative approaches may include any of the following. It could include sale to private entities with a use-approved guidelines that are consistent with your community's visions and plans, along with financial contributions for the ultimate redevelopment of the site. Or it could mean sale or contribution to a special purpose agency or an authority that could be charged with the responsibility for planning and executing the redevelopment of the state of the site and empowered with bonding or other capital authority to be able to make the investments necessary. Or it could mean holding the land effectively in trust for the same development as a market conditions consistent with your community's vision improve, in the sense of saying, well, let's be patient and hold that for the proper time. Or it could include a public-private partnering with public stakeholder contributes to the land and potentially additional capital in exchange for a stake in future benefits or development that will bring. That was the case for the steel stacks project. Utilization and leveraging the public institutional philanthropic capital that already has been earmarked or is likely to be made available to the community is also another path. Or finally, there could be an additional public acquisition of the privately held lands to further seed the redevelopment, create a critical mass, with the acquired land being added to one or more of the other alternatives that we noted above. There is really a vast menu of things and many case studies that guide you so you can choose the right path for that. And to be clear, none of these alternatives and numerous other iterations of them are achieved without difficulty patience and persistence. That is the one thing you will need, persistence. However, the panel senses that the public and the private stakeholders are poised, that we really sense that you are at the threshold to actively engaging with the community and then go forward control ownership discussions so that you're able to take control of this. No higher priority can be put on any task than development and articulation of these goals. So articulating goals or being really firm with the purpose of it and hanging on to them by water is really, I think, one of the most important things. So a clear definition of the goals, the scope, and the intended results of the development of the district must be established right from the onset, working closely with the key stakeholder groups by the appointed entity that's going to do this. This project definition is going to form the basis of an ongoing site redevelopment process that's going to evolve and is going to be further refined as initiatives planning, financial structure, and partnerships are developed. The project definition would address the key goals that the panel has understood from all the conversations throughout this week should be driving the need for public, greater public interest in the site. Why are we even doing this? And as we understood this, these goals are, number one, to generate high-quality jobs in a resilient and a diverse ecology of businesses that are rooted in your community, not coming from Belgium or some other place, and that they are going to benefit from the region's unique assets, the things that really make your economy truly yours. The scope of this task is to recast those large tracts of obsolescent heavy industrial properties on the Georgetown waterfront into an integrated waterfront district for the new economy. The intended result is for the district to serve as an incubator, and that has been a big word for us, an incubator for new emerging and re-energized business initiatives, the ones that are here and the ones that might come and be attractive. And the district is to provide opportunity and serve as a supportive environment for job creation. That's goal number one, as we understood it, of course, from the discussion. Goal number two is to open the access to the extensive frontage of your waterfront that is transitioning from heavy industrial to create a publicly accessible common asset, something the area can use and enjoy and derive businesses from, that supports that this new economy and complements and enhances the beauty, the great beauty that you have here and the amazing character that you must preserve and in some areas bring back in this historic Georgetown. The scope is an expanded public waterfront that is going to extend from Wood Street on all the way across and continuing up to the 17 bridge and all of those lands behind it. And the intended result is for the waterfront to become a publicly accessible asset that provides waterfront public spaces and activities and enhances experience and attractiveness of this incubated district and also remains, and this is important, a working waterfront that supports maritime businesses and activities that are an essential part of Georgetown's history, its economy, and its natural beauty. And the goal number three is to create a vehicle for opportunity. We heard that time and time again about people who come back and are looking for opportunities, and people who are coming back and looking for a place of community. It's for all the residents of Georgetown, but also for the region, that this is really seen as a regional asset across the river. The scope of this is that the site's potential, and this is important, it transcends the boundaries of the site of Georgetown. It really is very much about the county and in fact, really about the state. The site must serve as an instrument for advancement and prosperity and for a broader community and an integrated community. The intended outcome is for the site to become a fully integrated district for the city that is woven by this finely scaled network that can describe the documents, and that it is an incubator for new economy. A new Georgetown Library, City Hall, an outdoor amphitheater, sports and recreation venues, and all these other things will anchor this incubator district and really serve to make it great. So the concept of uses, you know, keeping with the singular focus of this district as a new economy creating job district, the uses could be industrial. They could be geared as incubator spaces for new and existing business in technology, marine, food, light manufacturing, research, and education fields. And other ancillary uses like retail and housing can be permitted just insofar as they are supportive of the jobs and place-making mission. And of course, meeting conference space, which is something that was also mentioned as a great need, are also seen as appropriate to support tourism and to support businesses. So, you know, they say that to plan is human, but to implement is divine. And this is the part that it's really all about the action.
Thank you, Antonio. Good morning, everyone. During its time in Georgetown, the panel heard frequent concerns from across the community about the environmental condition of the site, responsibility for the cost of cleanup, and the feasibility of cleanup. Managing the site's environmental legacy will, of course, be critical to Georgetown's future, so let's talk a bit about that now. Without knowing details about the site's environmental specifics, the steel mill could be classified as a potential brownfield site, which the US EPA defines as a property, the expansion, redevelopment, or reuse of which may be complicated by the presence or potential presence of a hazardous substance, pollutant, or contaminant. In the likely event that the site is contaminated, the brownfield's redevelopment process is complicated, time-consuming, and expensive. It is not easy, but it is imminently possible, and Georgetown is not alone in the need to manage contamination at a former industrial site. Take, for example, the San Francisco neighborhood of Dogpatch, shown on this slide, which has successfully made the transition from a site of heavy industry to a thriving residential neighborhood. Thousands of similar sites across the country and around the world have been remediated and redeveloped over the past several decades, and the Georgetown Steel Mill can follow in this tradition of land recycling, leaving behind a site that no longer poses a threat to humans, soil, and groundwater, and setting the stage for redevelopment that can yield multiple economic, social, and environmental benefits. It is critical to understand that until the site's environmental condition has been assessed, Georgetown will not have the data necessary to know how long and at what cost the site can be remediated. To that point, as this slide shows, land recycling requires four steps. Number one, identify your sites. Two, perform an environmental assessment to characterize the contamination. Three, plan and implement a remediation strategy to remove or immobilize contaminants and prevent contact with humans, wildlife, or other parts of the natural environment. And four, redevelop the site for beneficial uses. Responsibility for assessment and cleanup, also referred to as environmental liability, depends upon a site's ownership. State and federal law place responsibility for cleanup with polluting parties, although environmental liability may be transferred as part of the purchasing process. I want to emphasize that regardless of who executes the cleanup process, environmental remediation is not something that happens to Georgetown. Local leadership on the part of local government and engagement on the part of community members is essential for this process to succeed. Characterizing contamination starts with an examination of a property's past uses. This initial historical study of the site is what is called a phase one environmental site assessment, and that gives us clues as to what contaminants we might expect to find in the soil and or groundwater. During a phase two assessment, subsurface samples are analyzed to confirm the type, level, and location of contamination on site. Members of the community and local leadership may wonder what remediation can really achieve. As my colleague Don described, the state of the site is a mystery to most of Georgetown's residents, and as I noted earlier, the feasibility of cleanup is a concern we heard repeatedly. I'd like to stress that because it is extremely difficult and expensive to restore a site to pristine conditions, the goal of remediation is to ensure that land is cleaned up consistent with zoning and public health risk based on the intended reuse of the property. With the permission of regulators, remediation plans sometimes opt to contain rather than remove contamination. In this case, regulatory authorities require developers to continue to monitor the site in order to prevent any release of contamination into the environment. Engineering controls are physical solutions, and institutional controls are legal and land use tools. Both are intended to continue to minimize health risks into the future.
While the environmental component of the site will be challenging, resources are available to support you throughout this process. And this is critical because leadership at the local and community levels is a precondition for any successful land recycling project. The US EPA and South Carolina Department of Health and Environmental Control offer assessment, cleanup, job training, and revolving loan fund grants to lessen the financial burden for both public and private parties. Free technical assistance is also available through a number of nonprofit entities and universities. Atlantic Station in Atlanta is an example of a project that has benefited from some of these resources. While difficult, time-consuming, and costly, environmental remediation is the only way forward for the site and for Georgetown. There are no shortcuts, but there is help. Our report will contain detailed information about resources to help you move forward in this domain. I'd like to turn now to additional questions about implementation. Drawing on my colleagues' previous comments about vision, planning, and design, as we have emphasized before, the transformation of a site of this magnitude and complexity will take place over several steps. The panel believes that a series of phased milestones, examples of which are illustrated on this slide, can become a focus for forward movement. For example, in 6 months, stakeholders could establish lines of communication with the site owner and engage in other preliminary preparation, such as planning for and instituting a community educational program. In 1 year, the city and partners could establish a redevelopment corporation, as well as expectations and norms for the corporation's communication with the community. In 2 years, the redevelopment corporation and partners could secure access to the site, hire corporation staff, such as a project manager and other key support staff, secure site access, engage in planning around specific issues such as waterfront access and use, circulation, and other key priorities, develop a technical understanding of the sinkhole and drainage issue, grow an understanding of the transactional component necessary to convey the sites, and develop plans for environmental assessment and remediation. The corporation could also develop plans for initial public development and investment, such as parks. In 2021, 5 years from now, it could be possible to complete environmental remediation and initiate anchor public and private investment. And in 2036, 20 years from today, development could be substantially complete. As noted in our guiding principles, the timing of development is critical to providing the private sector with the reduction in risk necessary to spur private investment. Initial public investments include access-driven horizontal infrastructure, such as those intended to support connectivity and circulation, as my colleagues described earlier. Other later public investments could include the Georgetown Commons, Waterfront Park, and marine uses, such as public docks. Other public investments can support activation of these spaces through interim uses that highlight arts and culture and support small business development, as my colleague Juanita described earlier. Remember East Macon Arts Village in Macon, Georgia, and the Hall in San Francisco. As Juanita stressed, these can be long-term initiatives, but they don't have to be. Interim use is a powerful tool for generating impact in the near term. With that, I'd like to thank you and my colleagues very much and pass the mic back over to Alex.
I did not deliberately fib to you. Clearly, we took a little bit more than an hour. Hopefully, from that, part of what you get from this massive information, which is admittedly difficult to absorb in as it comes through the fire hose, but I hope it also gives you a sense of the complexity and the immensity of this type of an opportunity. But at the same time, and I can tell you from sitting in the room with my colleagues now for a week, it's reflective of the passion and the excitement about achieving that opportunity. And that's really our message for you here today. So let me tell you real quickly, or hopefully real quickly, what I think we told you this morning. We told you that you have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to shape the identity and future of Georgetown for yourselves, for your children, your grandchildren, and generations to come. the chosen and unique identity of Georgetown, not something borrowed or adapted from somewhere else. We told you that you have the power, the authority, and most importantly, the responsibility to control the shaping of that identity. We already know that you possess the drive and the will. You must translate that, the drive and the passion, you must translate that into will, decisiveness, and action. We told you that the site is a vehicle and a platform upon which you will shape Georgetown's identity and affect far-reaching social, physical, and economic change throughout the community and the region. We told you that redevelopment of the site is also the vehicle to more fully knit the Georgetown community together with its second greatest asset, the waterfront and the natural environment that has been blessed with. The greatest asset? Sitting in the room, along with your neighbors. That would be all of you, and that's what's going to make all of this happen. We told you that while this is a very long process, years, perhaps decades in the making, perhaps not, you have many tasks to begin today, many choices to make, many milestones that you will achieve, not many, that you will achieve in the coming months. We told you that the achievement of those milestones will yield many highly visible and impactful changes to the site and the broader Georgetown community, to its social, economic, and its physical fabric. Through changes that you will create, that you will see come to fruition and benefit from starting Monday. Yes, we are charging you with Monday. That is what was on Sarah's chart. And continuing through many months and years of hard work ahead. We told you that you will achieve those milestones and benefit from those changes because they will be driven by a vision, one based on jobs and economic activity benefiting all. Today we gave you a comprehensive starting place for that vision. You will come together, debate, and adopt a vision embraced by the entire Georgetown community. As Mayor Riley said earlier this week, working on the vision and getting it right is the hardest and most important part. We couldn't agree more. We told you that you have a broad and deep canvas to paint on, with many short-term, mid-term, and long-term physical and economic options to consider. Executing those options will signal to the Georgetown community and the broader market that momentum is gaining, fundamentals are improving, Georgetown is a place to invest, and a place of desirable social, economic, and lifestyle options for multiple generations and all Georgetonians, for a growing group of investors and others wanting to be here. We told you that despite challenging market and economic fundamentals from the past and even today, the redevelopment plan, which is derived from your vision and efforts, will yield the certainty and prerequisites for significant public and private investment in the community. Capital, investors, and even us developers crave certainty regarding the future. Your work is what will provide a significant measure of that certainty. That is the investment that will lift all Georgetonians. We told you much about the importance of transformational change, the courage to embrace it, and the benefits it brings. At the same time, your vision and plan will ensure that transformational changes enhance existing unique elements of the community, culture, historical, arts, economic, physical. This is about embracing the community holistically, not about destroying the old to create the new. We told you that you are undertaking this journey with many resources at your disposal. The vision you adopt, the redevelopment plans you embrace, and the action plan you execute each come with many tools and precedents used and being used by other communities throughout the country and the globe. We painted a picture, a physical, economic, and social picture of what Georgetown may look like 20 years from now. Again, perhaps less, perhaps a little more. That picture has pieces that you strive for and build piece by piece. It's you that will build the masterpiece. And finally, I want to return to words that I shared with a number of you on Monday night. Concepts that I learned from a previous ULI encounter with Joe Riley a number of years ago, and concepts that we as land use professionals and community leaders practice every day. Vision, persistence, patience, persistence. It's really easy to say. It's really hard to execute. It is indispensable to the achievement of your goals. It is now in your hands. You have many to help. We thank you for the privilege and opportunity of sharing this week with you and our thoughts, and we very much look forward to repeatedly returning to Georgetown to see your many successes.
Get some nice examples of the fish market in Seattle and the gas district thing there. Bethlehem Steel, I think making Georgia. These are cities of 100,000, 75,000, or even more in Seattle. Is there an example of this scale of a redevelopment project that's happened in a town of 9,000 or something closer to our size?
While somebody grabs a mic down there, I will tell you that the general answer is twofold. One, yes. And number two, I think the important thing to draw from those examples were the principles that went into developing them. It was activation and community vision and reuse. And all of that is scalable, and all of that has been scaled, and much of that we will include in our final report examples of that, which I'm not sure everyone wanted to sit and listen for another 3 or 4 hours, but certainly they are out there. Ken, you want to point to a couple?
I'd like to say that one of the projects that we've shown as an example was of similar scale. It's in Bend, Oregon. It's called the Old Mill District, and there were two sawmills that were shut down in the 1990s. And the plan started in 1994 and it's been substantially complete this year. It's a mixed-use development on the river, has all the elements that we have talked about. So yes, this is only one example of in bringing the natural part of it back, and also reusing some of the buildings and creating new synergy and energy in a small town in Oregon that it was connected to. So, yes, there are good examples, and the people in the town, that's about 15,000, so it's close to where you are, but they're growing rapidly. This has spurred a lot of development, and I'd like to say that the town thought initially that it was going to compete with the downtown. It's only added to the power of the downtown, so it's a good example.
And I had the privilege of visiting that with Ken as well, and I certainly can attest to that. Any other questions? Well, we not only wish you the best of luck, but we plead with you to use the resources that are available to you, including our ULI colleagues here in South Carolina. And thank you very much for being here.